There you go. Hunter S. Thompson.
I'll be interpreting for Dr. Thompson.
You go ahead.
Hey, right there. You have no place to hide.
You are low now!
You gotta be careful. Be very careful.
Here, right, you son of a bitch. Here, take this.
I hear there's a start date on the film Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas with Rhino Films, except there's a few problems. There's no script, there's no director, and there's no talent. And we're set to shoot January 29th, I hear. Is that true?
I believe that's true. But I think you have accurate information. And so what? All right. I didn't mean to get off on this kind of start.
You want to let him on fire?
He's not answering the question.
No, none of that's true, but you're going up. It's not because of what you ask, you know. It's not because of any elegance or articulation that you have. It's because you seem like a lawyer with a grudge.
Right? Want him out?
I think so, yeah.
All right.
I want to hear him scream. It's just that you...
Where?
CNN's
there. Let's try to get there now.
Kind of in a hurry.
You haven't been fired by Rolling Stone. You really aren't anywhere.
Tonight you're going to be at a very posh Upper East Side literary club, being a guest of honor among, you know, the cream of New York's literati. So why all the fuss on the 25th anniversary of the publication of Fear and Loathing? I guess somebody's trying to say that the book has relevance today.
It is odd that, you know, here we are sitting in the Rolling Stone boardroom. It looks like some kind of a plastic cubicle out of 2004. And 25 years ago, you know, we were operating out of a loft in San Francisco, and, you know, shunned as dope creatures. I guess that's really what it was. You know, it kind of brought the adventure back. I think it's the attitude that makes it kind of enduring. And I think I was celebrating the last time that it was possible to get away with this kind of stuff. Like the end of the 60s, the wave had rolled back. Broken rolled back. I was still on trial, you know, in Aspen.
No, really?
Yeah.
That's still going on?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
For blowing somebody up, or what
is it for? No, I was hunted down on election night by the cops. Where I was leading the movement to take on the Aspen Ski Company, and we beat them. They were trying to expand the airport runway. Beat them, but on election morning, on the way home, I was arrested, and they've had me on trial ever since. Imagine being pulled over and blowing a .053.
What's legal? What's illegal?
.10 is DUI.
So you're halfway there.
.053. Is the difference between me drinking this and not drinking it. You know, that, whatever that is.
So how are they making that stick?
They're not.
John Cusack.
Well, this is the letter. And when I was arrested, it was last year. It was a bungling, a vicious arrest, political arrest. They were trying to bust me on election night.
Which they did, but they were about 3 hours late when we won the election. Let's say, and B2C company by a huge margin. I'm a great believer in local politics. So when I was arrested for the same reason, I wrote this letter to the district attorney, and I offered it as help. It's called "How to Deal with the Police."
Dear Mr. Willis,
Mr.
Willis, I am given to understand that you want me to come into the courthouse and officially surrender to you in front of witnesses so that you can formally rearrest me on some kind of vague chicken shit charge cooked up by Officer Short on the night of November 7th, 8th, 1995, in the course of our bizarre encounter on Cemetery Lane, as I was very skillfully driving home on an utterly deserted road after delivering the keynote address at a major political rally full of people who planned to wake up the next morning, election day, and kick the shit out of the Aspen Ski Commission. Is my information correct? Did that vengeful dingbat actually fail to serve me with a valid legal summons? Did he botch everything that night? Was he so crazy that he couldn't even arrest me properly? And is that why you want me to drive at top speed into town so you can get your picture in the papers while you slap handcuffs on me and swell up like a toad for the cameras? Lawson, have you no shame? Are you a Nazi? Are you nuts with lust for your upcoming 15 minutes of fame? Has it come to this, that you have to beg, bitch, and cajole your victims to turn themselves in and abandon all hope for everything except humiliation and jail? How long, oh Lord, how long?
But it's cost me, I don't know, $30,000. I'm trying to make the point that people have to stand up to the police. I found myself in that position before.
It's taking a lot of time.
Oh, yeah, we're going to bust him and get him. He will be sent to wherever the sheriff went. Ah, thanks.
Thank you.
Let's put it here.
In the cold, clear air of the Rockies, the political and social problems that dominated the country's elections last week had a unique simplicity. What kind of sheriff do they want in the West these days? Could the conventional, establishment citizens of Aspen elect as their sheriff, bring themselves to vote for a hippie, a freak, an acid head, a man who openly smokes grass, marijuana? Hundreds of hippies and freaks have escaped to the Rockies from the American system, the cities they detest. But here last week, the comfortably off rebel young dropped back into the system and fought an election. The defending sheriff, Carol Whitmire, represents the Old West, traditional values. He's the goodie.
I don't know what
Hunter S. Thompson, a shaven-headed writer, is, I suppose, the baddie. Pot-smoking, an unusual-looking contender for sheriff.
I think the marijuana laws are one of the reasons that has engendered this lack of respect that cops complain about all over the country. When you get a whole generation that grows up as felons, and they know the law is ridiculous, and they're told all this gibberish about it, it drives you crazy and makes your brain soft and your feet fall off. And, Even the police know it's a silly law.
If Hunter Thompson wins, we'll have to see exactly if he's going to back up what he says. If he does, we're going to have murders here. People are not going to take that.
Yeah, the only compromise I made on the platform was that I agreed that the deputies would not be allowed to eat mescaline while on duty.
At the Freak Party headquarters, they were convinced that they had organized their vote successfully.
All with registration cards. All the same name.
That seemed important at the time. But certainly I would have been arrested. No question. I mean, I would have been charged. If I'd been elected, it would have just, all hell would have broken loose.
Hunter, 182. Whitmire, 137. Ricks, 10.
Yeah!
Voting was from 7 till 7, and early in the day, Freak Power went into a lead that excited them. Hunter Thompson put on his wig as night, the temperature, and his hopes fell. It began to look as if the solid citizens of Aspen were turning out to vote in unprecedented numbers.
One could do it. One could do it.
We won, we
The sheriff won by only 400 votes, though, out of 2,500.
I think I, unfortunately proved what I set out to prove. And it was more a political point than a local election. And I think the original reason was to prove it to myself. That the American dream really is f***.
He had a sense of the closing down of everything coming. And Nixon was going to be reelected, remember that? Yeah, it was not a happy time. And the 60s were kind of over, you know, Nixon was president. So this is kind of a, I think, not consciously, but reading it now, it was the attitude of the 60s that we were on top. We could, you know, we were going to prevail and have fun at the same time. The greedheads were doomed. But Nixon brought an end to that. Thank God for Watergate. I think it saved a lot of lives. Oh, yeah. And I felt defeated then. I take politics seriously.
So what about your relationship with Jan? It's it's seemed to be rocky over the years.
Oh, boy, you bet. Yeah. Yeah. Her friendship to survive him firing me and canceling my life insurance while I was on the way to the Saigon cover of the war in Vietnam. Yeah, we've had our ups and downs. No, where is this rat's maze? What?
This way.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, they didn't seem to really understand that in fact is the case.
What's this, another boardroom?
A conference room.
Conference room. Yeah, they're all glass, right? Yes. Oh, look at this. Look at this. Hold on to these flowers. Hmm. All right. Armed. Okay, let's go. See, I go from flowers to this so quickly. What's this?
Here's Uncle Hunter now. Oh, Hunter! Hunter, go! You bastard! Fuckhead! Oh, shit, Paul.
You're okay. You're okay. Thank God we have this. Look at the little hands. I'm taking a look at the room. You gotta look at the room.
Oh.
Dang. It's terrible.
Awful.
Thank you.
Hunter. Hunter, there are no fucking windows. Are you doing here?
No, he sprayed it right into there.
There are no windows.
Oh, look at your hair. It's my hair.
It's all disappearing. Some kind of air is taking
it. Oh, that's it. Turn on the air conditioner.
Oh, my God.
It is not too late to cancel this party. Can't this happen? No, the party goes on your bar.
Here.
Your bar.
Look at
your bar.
Look at
you. Thank you. Yeah. Fuck.
So I'm over here now, but I'm only here to defend Hunter. Oh yes, because it's a fun thing to do. I mean, I've got to go to court tomorrow to cover the Hunter S. Thompson trial, you know, for drunk driving. It's a tiny, tiny misdemeanor, really, what he's done, you know, compared to what he has done in the past. This is a little thing, you know, but nevertheless, he's taken down a point of, you know, of principle to court, and he believes he's being victimized, and I think he's right. Yeah. Okay. Los Angeles Magazine. Great. Thank you. Lovely to talk to you. Bye-bye, Amanda. Bye-bye.
What are you going to do?
Hunter's liver on holiday in a deck chair, you know? It's just his liver slumped in a deck chair, you know, trying to recover. And there are other livers along the beach playing ball and things like that from other people. So it's a holiday thing. You
That's
know?
Great.
So I'm just going to take part. That's why I've gone in for this... Grey's Anatomy, I decided to do all parts of Hunter's body.
Oh, yeah?
I'm worried about him, yeah. Well, because, you know, he could die. That's what I'm saying. And he's overdone it, you know. When I die and the limits are clear, gonna go to the place that's the place. When I lay me down.
I want to tell you that, look around you, man. This is a place where you want to spend a weekend. We have hot pools, cold tubs, whatever. We have whatever you want, really. Almost anything you want. And I guess what I'm talking about is fun. I'm going on trial, by the way, in 2 weeks. And don't let that bother you.
I got this offer. Ralphie!
Yes, yes. Well, we
have pigs. There we are.
Holy Christ, take a look at that. We should get a lineup for this stuff.
Yeah, there's a lineup in order.
All right, man.
When that hand goes off.
Oh, it's here, the Enigma. I see. And are you in it? As a sort of a... not a test case, but...
an extreme personality, right?
Yeah. And you found out that it's you?
Well...
in here. Describe. You got a brain. Oh, there we go. Oh, yeah. The epitome of the modern eccentric. Literary maverick, Hunter Thompson, author of Fear and Loathing Las Vegas, takes aim at his snowbound typewriter near his home at Woody Creek, Colorado. Calling himself the champion of fun, Thompson has been known to videotape an assortment of his shenanigans, including setting a Christmas tree ablaze in his fireplace. I think you come into this category, actually. Obsessive compulsive personality disorder.
Does it say that?
It would be considered antisocial and therefore a disorder. Antisocial.
Now, wait a minute, no.
William
Faulkner said, he was talking about the need, you know, the will to write. And one of his lines was, a writer will walk over his grandmother to get the book finished.
Yes, that makes sense.
If that's not obsessive compulsive.
Yeah.
Ralph, if I am one of these, welcome to the club, Bubba.
Yeah, well, we might find that. Imagine, I came from England, I was told to go to Kentucky Derby. It was an important magazine. I didn't know what it was. Scanlon's. It was a real magazine.
First trip.
And I just went there. Never thought about credentials. Didn't occur. First trip, ever.
You know, I was struggling desperately. You got, trying to get Derby credentials like 3 days before the Derby. Press box, everything, total for two. Oh, I knew people at the Courier, and I scored them for everything except the inside, the governor's box, the inner circle.
We did get in there.
Oh, you bet we did. We stopped in there. We went everywhere you wanted.
And what condition were you in at the end of that job?
I was totally finished, wrecked. Yeah, without rhyme or reason.
You were gassed.
But I actually had done some drawings.
Just drawn it.
I'd done drawings.
Here's the real truth.
By this time, Ralph wouldn't even order coffee. He kept asking for more water. It's the only thing they have that's fit for human consumption, he explained. Then, with an hour or so to kill before he had to catch the plane, we spread his drawings out on the table and pondered them for a while, wondering if he'd caught the proper spirit of the thing. But we couldn't make up our minds. His hands were shaking so badly that he had trouble holding the paper, and my vision was so blurred that I could barely see what he'd drawn. Shit, I said, we both look worse than anything you've drawn here. He smiled.
I remember saying that.
He smiled. You know, I've been thinking about that, he said. We came down here to see this terrible scene. People all pissed out of their minds and vomiting on themselves and all that. And now, you know what? It's us.
In 1971, you were off to Las Vegas, and you said, oh, I've got something here, Ralph, that you may be able to illustrate. You know about this. Because that was the sort of... it just, you took an attorney with you on the... I've always thought that was what justified it, and why I never took an umbrage about you not taking me.
I was doing another story in L.A., and I took him there to get him away from his Chicano, his brown power bodyguards. You know, these are killers. And I couldn't get Oscar away from his bodyguards. That's when I devised a plan to sneak off to Las Vegas.
So that...
I went to the Polo Lounge. ditched the bodyguard by accident. Got this assignment. I knew I already had the assignment. I just accepted it. It was Sports Illustrated. I wasn't going to do it. I just saw a chance to get Oscar
out of it. Yeah.
Away from these people.
But you think of all these years, you might have bruised me in a way that I...
I realize it never. It never occurred to me.
No, it's only thought, well, why didn't he take me on that trip?
No, they call it Delta Enterprise.
Ralph, please, Ralph. Let us not forget or ignore or fail to count in here the fact that when the time came to do the art, who did the art of the articles and the book, Ralph? Who called? It wasn't the fucking stork who brought you that assignment, was it? It wasn't something that went over my head. I had to overrule the art director and it really sucked.
I thought to myself that what I had presented myself as was a ready answer to all your problems.
And I took it right readily. That's why you illustrated the book.
Wasn't the only reason.
Look at the cheap penny,
Wasn't the only reason, Hunter.
Nickel and dime,
wasn't the only reason.
What reason?
There was a bigger reason. Why? You asked me to illustrate that book. No one would have noticed it if it had not been for my illustrations. No.
Okay. Be sure you get that.
Well, I've got it.
This explains though, I'm talking to Wayne here. Be sure you get...
Oh, I got it.
I wanted a better record than what I've been dealing with for all these years.
Yeah.
They're icons. They are some of the most well-known images, certainly in 20th century American art, if not in world art. They are the icons that everybody recognizes. They say, well, these pictures represent something. Oh, it's Hunter Thompson's book. So they practically, but not quite, that either Hunter S. Thompson is the same. No. Yeah. Hunter S. Thompson is probably the artist as well. That's what's
Holy
happened.
Holy shit, this is really dark thinking, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, Rob, there's nothing to do about this. It's getting late. Is that a bad dedication there?
To all the friends and strangers, and even enemies who answered the great roll call when I was seized by rabid scum who tried to put me in prison.
That's not bad.
No, it's good.
Send lawyers, guns, and money. Send lawyers, guns, and money.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. I'm Warren Zevon. And we're here to spend an evening in the dangerous company of America's greatest writer, Louisville's own Dr. Hunter S. Thompson.
Thank you for all coming tonight to Hunter S. Thompson Day. One of the reasons we're here, it's the 25th anniversary of the publication of the book Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. And just a couple weeks ago, the Modern Library edition came out, Random House puts this out, and it puts Hunter Thompson's book, which he wrote in 1971, as one of the all-time American classics. It's actually between Tolstoy and Thackeray in the Modern Library list. So we're partially here to pay tribute to that book also.
It's about time we recognized our greatest literary talent, don't you think, Hunter Thompson? Finally, Louisville, we've done it. I was rereading Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, and Hunter has the most incredible imagery, and it sort of brings back things that you and I have thought about over the years, like the image of your dead grandmother crawling up your leg with a knife in her mouth. I mean, that's something we've all thought about.
Hey!
Remember!
Last night.
Tom Wolf?
Let's get that. Let's get that strike.
What are you doing, man?
The thing that strikes me about this evening is that when I worked at Rolling Stone, the big myth was that Hunter was going to never work for Rolling Stone again. Things were very dark. Money was owed. There was confusion. There was enormous bitterness. But we tried to think of what would bring Hunter back to working at Rolling Stone. Jan and I discussed this. Jan said, "Oh, we love each other, but it'll never work." And Hunter said, "Oh, I love him, but I'll never work for him again." He says, "Rat." What happened to us was that you all remember Roxanne Pulitzer?
Well, I have to tell you, Hunter and I had a very odd first meeting, and that was I was at a 21-day trial in Palm Beach. And he walked into the trial on the second day, and he was in khaki shorts, sneakers, a Hawaiian shirt, dark glasses. He sat down in the front row, and they, out of 400 journalists, they only allowed 10 in there. And every day he had a first row seat, and the judge said, "I'm so honored to have you here, Mr. Thompson. That should have been the tip right there that I was in trouble."
I mean, what a scene. It was the monsoon season down there. Everybody with any money at all had left Palm Beach, you know, to flee in this driving horrible rain. Nothing to do at night except get drunk. I went over to Roxanne's house. And, yeah, we abused a lot of substances. But then have to go right into the courtroom at 7 in the morning to get in line for the 12 seats. It went on and on forever. It was like being lost in, you know, with Captain Nemo under the sea. It was weird.
But anyway, this is what Hunter wrote about himself when he was in Palm Beach. "I am living the Palm Beach life now, trying to get the feel of it, royal palms and raw silks, cruising the beach at dawn on a red Chrysler convertible with George Shearing on the radio and a head full of bogus cocaine and two beautiful lesbians in the front seat beside me. We're on our way to an orgy in a mansion not far from the sea, and the girls are drinking champagne from a magnum we bought from Dunhill's, the chic and famous restaurant. There is a wet parking ticket flapping under the windshield wiper in front of me, and it bores me. I am giddy from drink, and the lesbians are waving their champagne glasses at oncoming police cars, laughing gaily and smoking strong marijuana in a black pipe as we cruise along Ocean Boulevard at sunrise, living our lives like the dolphins." Which brings us back to the story. For good or ill, not everybody who failed to understand the social contract has been terminally banished to the West Coast. Some of them still live here, and every once in a while they cause problems that make headlines all over the world. The strange and terrible case of young Roxanne Pulitzer is one of these, and that is the reason I came to Palm Beach, because I feel a bond with these people that runs deeper and stronger than mere money and orgies and drugs and witchcraft and lesbians and whiskeys and red Chrysler convertibles. My God. Bestiality is the key to it, I think. I have always loved animals. They are different from us. And their brains are not complex, but their hearts are pure. And there is usually no fat on their bodies, and they will never call the police on you, or take you in front of a judge, or run off and hide your money. Just remember, animals do not hire lawyers. Yes, Hunter, we love you.
What was it like to have Hunter Thompson as your father? What can I say? What I can tell you is what I learned from my father, what I respect and admire in him. I've learned that the surface truth is rarely the real truth, And as a result, I've become cynical about the motivations of corporations, politicians, and law enforcement. Above all, he makes me think and pay attention. He demands in everything that he does that you set aside your habits of perception and pay attention to what is happening right now and deal with it. That's where the fun and excitement are, in not knowing what's going to happen.
They pulled me over because they knew who I was, rather than an unknown person allegedly swerving over a line.
Yeah, it's based on who the judge believes. No. And proving that anybody who believes he didn't know what my car was or who I was, and to think that he could be on the police force, be that unaware, where is he working, fucking Mars?
Ah, but don't get me wrong, Lawson. I'm on your side, or at least I was until the bungling dunce harassed me for 3 1/2 hours on election day and made an ass of himself in the jail. It was ugly. He went haywire when he finally understood that I was not drunk and none of his high-tech drunk buster machines were going to give him the numbers he wanted. He was like an ape trapped in chains. His fellow officers were mortified and so was I. And that is why I feel the real sympathy is for you, because I know the people you work for and I know how sick they are. But don't worry, Lawson, the pigs will soon be out of the poke. Yes, sir, the fat is in the fire. Today's pig is tomorrow's bacon. Whoops. Sorry, but the rest is easy.
But well, what's my, what, I don't know if I should announce my $44 million lawsuit against the city, Dell, or Linda.
Hunter, it's time to go.
Oh, okay.
Well, we're going to publish him in the paper tomorrow, in the Daily News. Well, this is the Glidden today, we...
Oh, Glidden?
Yeah.
Ooh, you got it.
The hidden Glidden.
He was falling to bits, actually. He just gradually deteriorated. And I know that there came a moment when he didn't really know what he'd lied about half an hour before and what he was doing towards the end, and whether, you know, he'd said something and it was...
He could sense the trap was closing.
He could feel
closing
it.
Closing carefully around him.
Anybody decent or ass worm would throw the towel. I don't know what the hell Will's going to do. Must be a horrifying experience to have to sit there and listen to Glidden lie in court all the time.
See, defense attorneys get to pick their clients. DAs don't.
Yeah. Isn't that the man? That's him.
I've learned to appreciate family and loyalty to one's friends. I've never seen a community closer than the one in Aspen in which I grew up and that Hunter helped create and hold together. These people are serious about friendship. When someone is going through difficult times, there are suddenly more invitations to dinner, to watch football games, subtle invitations to talk and unload. If someone is done wrong by an outsider, then the offender finds himself on a collective blacklist.
But in another way, it's a cautionary tale, isn't it? For people, even of Hunter's stature, and he has stature. If at least he doesn't go to prison, they're going to smack his hands for it, you know.
But, you know, rather than prison, what'll happen is they'll send him to rehabilitation. And
is that what'll happen?
Want to test him for alcohol and drugs every day.
Yeah, but it's just outrageous, isn't it?
Indeed, your time is coming, whoreface. When I get your lame ass in court, you'll wish you'd been run over and killed by a Buick when you were 6 years old. We will skewer those swine on worldwide TV and put them in prison for perjury. Nobody in the valley will ever see them again. You filthy, stinking animal. Do you know what misprison of felony means, or aggravated conspiracy to obstruct justice? Are you aware of the terrible punishment that awaits a Maine pig like you?
Death to the weird!
Okay, that's it. I'll surrender on Wednesday.
Well, that letter was sent for the record. That's how I started this trial. So that's what I'm into. And I hope nobody here is inclined to think that I'm not doing my part against these people. But yeah, that's how I deal with the police. I think there are handbills you can have on your way out, just in case you get arrested anytime soon. Take this as a model.
Okay, we are here tonight for the purpose of something that we've all, and the people in this room have done practically everything that you can imagine, and some things you can't. But we're here for one purpose tonight, something that we have never done, and that is to take Hunter seriously. Okay? Something that he richly deserves, despite his behavior and his mode of dress and his headwear this evening. Hunter actually is a serious artist, very possibly the best one that's alive right now in his field, which doesn't really speak very well to the rest of us. But nonetheless, it is a distinction of utmost importance. And tonight, we are here to celebrate that. And Hunter, here is to Hunter as the artist, as the genius, as a man of his time, as someone who PhDs will be written about as soon as all of us who actually knew him are dead.
I think they must have had a better one than that.
Oh, of course. It's the worst one they could have done. Oh, well, we didn't see this.
Oh.
Looks like I'm being hauled out. Well, he really does like hanging out with celebrities.
What a lovely picture of you in the newspaper today,
Dad. Oh, my God.
I really enjoyed it.
Shit, I guess you did.
Carmel called me to say, he looked like that for real these days?
Shit, that was horrible.
This is the book which launches, or shall we say, cements the reassessment of Hunter Thompson as an important literary / journalistic figure, and at the same time as a big commercial book.
I don't recall that that requires any total reconstruction.
We're about to do a little of an unveiling here. Pretty fucking elegant, eh?
That's nice.
I think there's one element missing. I don't know exactly what it is yet. Here's another one.
Yeah, that's definitely the photo.
Yeah.
I should be dead, in fact, for this book.
I've always said that.
Yeah.
It would sell a lot more copies. Pointed this out.
A lot less trouble for everybody.
Be a good collector.
Wouldn't be sitting here.
Yeah. Would you like some scotch with your
ice? I had some. Yeah.
Nice. Nicely done.
You never know, boy.
I think we're getting off easy. That's just a bottle.
Oh, yeah. It hits and it spits out in the top crack. Whiskey spats everywhere.
Hell's Angels. Now, these are Hunter has. These are he has an endless amount of Hell's Angels photos. So
all of them classics.
That's Hunter photos
that's
the Angels.
That's Tiny and Jerry.
Is it French kissing?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's a pretty wild photograph.
That's quite a photograph. That's quite a photo. Who took that picture?
Me in the mirror.
That one?
Yeah, I thought that. I just thought I better get down because
I was about to die.
Was that what? Why was that?
That's what I, after I got stumped with the Hells Angels.
Oh, that's that.
That's why I finally made it back to back home.
You have always, I mean, you said early on that you figured that you would always be on the margins of society with a very small percentage of people who were like you.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, that's where we get to outlaw.
Is that...
I've never been approved by any majority.
But is that a kind of difficult way to be?
If you make it work, it's not.
Do you make it work? Do you find it... Have you not found it difficult?
Yeah, on occasion. They're still trying to lock me up all the time. The only things I've ever been arrested for, it turns out, are things I didn't do. Mm. All the crimes I really committed, it was... Maybe some people know about them. Yeah, I'm sure that some people do, but... Just an accident. Yeah, we'll try this. It's just a general feeling that I shouldn't be allowed to get away with it. But I've been pretty careful about trying to urge people who cannot live outside the law. You know, to throw, kick off the traces and run amok. I mean, some people are not made for it. I was a juvenile delinquent. I was a, the Billy the Kid of Louisville. Well, you know, it's actually pretty simple. I believed I was a writer. I knew I had to be a writer because I was not good at anything else. And I get along by, I survived by writing, making you know, literature out of what might otherwise be seen as craziness. You know, if I, a lot of things, if I didn't write about them, I could be in jail for it. Still.
Actually, Hunter first used the term fear and loathing in the early 60s. He wrote it the day he heard the news that John F. Kennedy was assassinated. That was the first time Hunter really used the phrase fear and loathing. The day of Kennedy's assassination, November 22nd, 1963, Hunter wrote, "There is no human being within 500 miles to whom I can communicate anything, much less the fear and loathing that is on me after today's murder. From now on, it's dirty pool and judo in the clinches. The savage nuts have shattered the great myth of American decency." From that point on, in coming years, fear and loathing became part of our American idiom. It's used constantly. And we have to read from the classic book, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, the actor Johnny Depp, who's from Kentucky. And Johnny's a big fan of Hunter's work and is also possibly going to be playing the main role, Raoul Duke, in the movie version of Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
Strange memories on this nervous night in Las Vegas. 5 years later, six. Seemed like a lifetime, or at least a main era. A kind of peak that never comes again. San Francisco in the middle 60s was a very special time and place to be a part of. Maybe it meant something. Maybe not in the long run. History is hard to know because of all the hired bullshit. But even without being sure of history, it seems entirely reasonable to think that every now and then the energy of a whole generation comes to a head in a long, fine flash. For reasons that nobody really understands at the time, and which never explain in retrospect what actually happened. There was madness in any direction at any hour. If not across the bay, then up the Golden Gate or down 101 to Los Altos or La Honda. You could strike sparks anywhere. There was a fantastic universal sense that whatever we were doing was right.
All right. Yep.
That we were winning.
Woo! Yes. All right.
And that, I think, was the handle. That sense of inevitable victory over the forces of old and evil. Not in any mean or military sense, we didn't need that. Our energy would simply prevail. There was no point in fighting on our side or theirs. We had all the momentum. We were riding the crest of a high and beautiful wave. So now, less than 5 years later, you can go up on a steep hill in Las Vegas and look west. And with the right kind of eyes, you can almost see the high water mark, that place where the wave finally broke and rolled back.
We've been speaking of your talents.
Thank you so much.
And, what are you going to do? What's your...
I was going to have an early bite to eat with my folks and then come back here. So, can I give you a call when I'm back?
Yeah. Oh, you might want to bring your folks out here and have them shoot a bomb, you know?
I know they'd enjoy that.
They want to shoot the shotgun. We can have them do it. It's a rush.
I'll run past them.
Yeah, all right.
All right. Well, I'll give you a call.
Yeah, we're working hard here.
Okay.
All right, dude.
Thanks.
Here you're having me leaving town on a plane midway in the picture? Well, how's that going to work?
Because there's a technical problem with adapting the book, which is the restitution.
So we go to, what, three or four airports? I fly out and go home somewhere?
You only get as far as LA.
You get as far as the airport, and then you get sent right back in a tidal wave. You get swept back in the tidal wave, which...
Tidal wave. What tidal wave are you talking about?
The one that you mentioned that left an entire generation high and dry.
That it just... Oh, the wave almost reached the
wave. Oh, yeah. Back. Yeah, it broke and rolled back, yeah.
And you can see the remains, you can see the...
Oh, all right, I didn't see that, yeah.
So you get swept back to Vegas in that.
But we have that on...
Pile of bones.
But first, on the plane...
What?
You should read the script.
Yeah, it's on page 44.
Read the script.
It's on page 44.
Good God, it's page 44.
We should write it in the script of the weather.
Yeah.
It sounds so horrible, I'm not sure I want to read it.
No, it's so good.
What are you going to do? Have some kind of animation, tidal wave?
For the tidal wave, yeah.
Oh, well, eat shit.
Because like the Wolverines.
What, is it some kind of hip thing to do animation, no?
No, is it supposed to make it? It's in there because it thinks it's going to bring the book out
better. Because of the book, I mean, we can get rid of the book.
Well, maybe you can convince me, but in cartoon tidal waves, I mean, to turn that one... really elegant statement. It's like a huge sapphire.
Oh, yeah.
It's some kind of a fucking joke where I'm being put on a tidal wave. I will sue you.
No, you don't need to sue me. Yeah. I'm at your disposal.
I really, really wish you would read the script.
You should read it.
The script can't be a lot different from what you're telling me, can it?
I'm extremely proud of it, and I feel like it's a fucking sapphire.
You're talking about a tidal wave with me being washed on it, aren't you?
No, but you must know better than anybody that to take something out of context and out of context of the structure is to do it harm.
Well, I don't like the idea of it, turning that isn't one of my best fucking things I've ever written, and then turn it into some kind of a stupid cartoon joke. I don't like, no.
That's one of the best things anybody's ever written.
Well, then I don't know, but why the hell do you want to choose that to have a cartoon and make a I just have to have a very high affection for that one piece, and so do other people. You know, we've read it.
So do we.
Well, I don't, you can see that it might be a little bit edgy when you're talking about putting it into cartoon form with me on some kind of tidal wave across some imaginary
Mickey Mouse Desert. I just don't think it's...
But you've been put in a cartoon form already across the Mickey Mouse Desert by Ralph Steadman, and all we're trying to do is follow the theme of the book.
You're talking about making characters out of these cartoons.
Just like the Steadman... Yeah, but I mean following the Steadman design. Sometimes it might be live action like the reptiles, the wine...
So we're mixing in moving cartoon figures...
With actual, people. Like it's really the well, actual reptiles.
I despise that.
You don't like...
You're asking me. I'm not saying that we're considering a lot of things. I'm just telling you.
Which don't you like? The cartoons or the sort of or the reptiles?
Well, the thing about me being carried across the desert on some tidal wave makes me really angry. Now the reptiles, that's been a problem we've had with other people.
So what would you like the reptiles to be like?
Well, I think Clive Arrowsmith had the best solution to the reptile problem. I'm sorry we didn't go ahead with it.
And what was the solution?
He said we would go to several of these farms that supply the San Diego Zoo, and we would get some alligators and some huge beasts and drug them up with quaaludes, take the alligators in there, prop them up on the bar, nail their paws to the bar, wait for them to come alive, the quaaludes wear off, nail their feet to the floor, and, that would be an outrage that it wasn't done. But
how would they carry how would those alligators be trained to carry a wine glass full of blood?
They wouldn't. They'd just be nailed to the fucking bar. They'd probably get loose eventually, Well, what the hell, they have these animal forms, and they train these, beasts for films. Yeah, a real animal is a... whatever it does, however dangerous it is, it's far preferable to some kind of shit-eating cartoon running around. It's going to be real hard. I'm going to be a real nasty bump to get over with this thing about me being put across the desert on some kind of tidal wave. It's a nasty shock to me.
But don't take it too hard, because we're here to participate in the creative process that is doing.
Yeah,
it's just a movie, and we're going to do it as impeccably as we can, and so that it doesn't offend your taste in any way.
That can't be the holy grail, but
no, but you're...
You think I'd be the only person who would object to cheapening this fucking thing with cartoons? Would I be some kind of lonely freak?
Here's the problem, is that you published a novel with cartoons.
I hired Ralph to do some drawings.
And they're great.
But if once they start becoming the characters, I think it is really a rotten and wrong thing to do. I would be opposed to this cartoon shit to my death under any circumstances.
That's reasonable.
Yeah, I mean, don't even think that I'm ever going to come around to it. It eats shit, and I hate it.
That's fair. That's reasonable.
And then nobody ever asked me before. I'm sorry, but if they told you I liked it or wanted it, that's an utter lie. And
I think maybe because of this, everybody expects to see that. That's the only visual they have right now. They don't have any other visual to...
What the fuck? They didn't have any visuals for Casablanca until the film.
They didn't.
The idea of substituting cartoons for real actors and real emotions and real thinking, I think, is really bad.
Well, I totally agree with that.
But you have to read the whole thing, and then you can...
Read it seven times. But we're going to have a problem seven times after I've read it seven times.
No, because after the first
time... Hey, the cartoon thing sucks. I'm sorry. I don't like the idea of having some shithead draw little things to make... If I wanted to do that, I would go to see cartoons on fucking Saturday afternoons with kids. Or Saturday morning.
You never liked cartoons, did you? Even... As a youth,
no.
As a lad, you didn't like cartoons.
Well, should I have? I've suffered from it. Do I look like I'm fucking deprived?
No, it seems to have done you no harm at all, the absence of cartoons. It seems odd, though, and ironic that your great literary work, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, has become associated with cartoons.
In your mind, perhaps.
Well, no, in the popular mind, I think,
the popular
demonstration.
Mind. I didn't write this for the popular mind.
I mean, read the script. And if it doesn't convince you, then we'll
what I really just present deeply, and what you're constantly scratching on here, and maybe you're, I don't know if you're doing it intentionally or not, even think it's funny, but the idea that you're turning my work into a cartoon...
No, sir!
...makes me fucking angry.
It was done by
your
friend.
And you've got about
friend.
Five fucking more minutes.
Your friend, in house. Ralph Steadman.
Hey, if you want to deal with Ralph, you go deal with Ralph.
Nope. That's why we came here. to see you instead.
But there's constant reference to my work as being no better than cartoons.
No.
It's really getting me angry.
I
tell you, there's one, and we got into two. Now you got three, you're out of here.
Okay.
We're out of here.
I don't think either of us ever said any such thing.
No, I don't think either of us ever
confided. And I don't think you think so either.
Well, you know, you keep talking about these cartoons and referring to my, my best work as something that should be put in the Mickey Mouse thing. I don't think that's really.
I don't think you think we said that either.
No, but you still have to read the script in order to say what you want to have.
Write your own fucking movie. Write your own story. You're a smart girl. Go ahead and do it. Just don't fuck with mine and make it a new cartoon.
No. But it's your problem. I think is with Stedman. We're not arguing with you. We agree with you.
Well.
No, but you see, we got our assignment not from you, but from the guys who love Stedman. You should be annoyed at the people who told us.
Hey, I am.
That Ralph Stedman,
man. I'm totally annoyed at
you. Because
I do want to make it clear to somebody. So who is it?
I would speak to Layla because she's really your point person.
Well, it's true.
The thing about the cartoons, I think, is.
Hi, it's Layla. I'm
not
here to leave a message.
All right. 99.
Thank you for
hospitality.
Thank you
very much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, we're having a little problem here with your goddamn stupid fucking cartoons and all this thing. I don't know who are... if you think you're in charge of this movie, we're going to have a real problem right now. Coming right on. And poor Alex Cox has had to leave here in tears. As the writer is saying that you told him to make fucking cartoons out of it and put Ralph's goddamn drawings in the cartoon characters. If you want war, here we go, baby. There's going to be a nasty fucking war.
Roland was a warrior from the land of the midnight sun, with a Thompson gun for hire and fighting to be done. The deal was made in Denmark on a dark and stormy day. So they set out for Biafra
to join the party. How was your trip, Ben?
Oh, slow and like it.
All right. And I got you a great suite, sixth floor over Sunset.
Do we have ice up here?
Sorry?
Do we have ice?
I could get you some if you like. I'll have some sent up. In the meantime, I'll take you up and show you the room. You've been here before.
Oh, yes.
Let me just show you this room.
I've been here longer than you have.
Don't forget the liquor.
You're welcome. We're up on six.
Six. Uh-huh.
A green apple.
Green apple, what's that mean?
Nobody ever said whether Eve ate a red or a green apple.
That's you.
Last time you hear, this has a little different view. This gives you a terrace.
Wait, where's the bedroom and all that stuff?
You get a fetish fry screen, some dove bars inside.
This is something like out of my Double Indemnity.
It definitely works, too. I just washed
the dishes. That's why we came here. Just so
you understand. But you have expensive. Reference to my work as being no better than cartoons.
No.
It's really getting me angry.
I know.
And I tell you, there's one, and we got into two. Now you got three, you're out of here.
Okay.
We're out of here.
I don't think either of us ever said anything.
So you have to.
But you still have to read the script.
They can't wait to get out.
Write your own fucking movie. Write your own story. You're a smart girl. Go ahead and do it. Just don't fuck with mine and make it a new cartoon.
If he would have said to you right there, if he would have said, all right, no cartoons, and we're going to go with freaks of nature.
Yeah. Yeah.
You would have said yeah.
Like yeah. That. Yeah.
Yeah, but well, I don't like me being, you turning on me at the end. I must say, I don't like that at all.
Well, he didn't by calling you.
Yeah, I called to find out.
But when Alex said, oh, you should talk to Layla. Like,
what should I have said? No, I know Layla for many years, and she would never say that. Fuck.
Yes, that would have been nice. I would have liked that. I would have accepted that show of confidence.
You got him on the movie. So after that,
no, that's what I was going on. I was pressured into it.
Oh, boy, keep these fuckers away from me.
Yeah, good. Yeah.
Here's the problem. Rhino has this May 20th start date. They do not want this movie not to go May 20th on the start date because they have the start date, and we have Johnny for that start date. If we lose Johnny on that start date, we don't know when we're doing this movie or how we're doing this movie. So we get rid of Alex Cox, and we have no replacement, or we don't know who's going to replacement, or Johnny doesn't approve of a replacement, or we can't get a replacement within 2 weeks from today. We don't have a movie starting on May 20th.
Well, I'm looking for some fun on this movie. Basically, that's really what I
agree.
I got my own definition of fun sometimes. I'm not so out of whack as people think. Yeah.
Who's that?
It looks like Mel.
Wow. Wow.
One, that driving while one's ability is impaired by alcohol is dangerous to the health and safety of the public and must be avoided at all costs. Two, that statements by police officers which are inaccurate or untruthful are dangerous to the administration of justice and must be avoided at all costs. To declare that in the administration of the criminal law, the end justifies the means. To declare that the government may commit crimes in order to secure the conviction of a private criminal would bring terrible retribution. Seven, the parties agree mistakes and or errors in judgment have been made by all parties, that each party will strive to avoid any such errors in the future, and that it is in the best interest of justice to go forward with the tendered agreement. Two, HST to do 24-month deferred prosecution in DWAI case.
Deferred prosecution means it disappears.
This was settled?
Yeah.
Well, they signed it, right? So.
Yeah.
Why does he say private criminal?
I said that. That's a quote from Louis Brandeis, who's a Supreme Court justice.
But why is it private criminals? What does that mean?
Where are private criminals?
I don't know. I'm not sure what it means. But like, isn't a public officer a private, you know, people?
Oh, private. Okay. To declare that in the administration of the criminal law, the end justifies the means. To declare that the government may commit crimes in order to secure the conviction of a private criminal would bring terrible retribution.
There you go, sir.
Are you a private criminal?
Yes. Yes. I like that. I think we should call Fear and Loathing private criminal.
Blazing right through Knoxville, out on Kingston Pike, then right outside of Bearden, there they made the fatal strike. He left the road at 90, that's all there is to say. The devil got the moonshine and the mountain boy that day.
And there was thunder over Thunder Road.
Thunder was his engine, and white lightning was his load.
And there was moonshine, quenched the devil's thirst.
The law, they never got him, 'cause the devil got him first. Law, they never got him, 'cause the devil got him first.
Thunder tolls.
I know you'll never like me, Eddie, but
you will speak, and you'll say, hi, I'm Edward.
Did he leave?
Edward.
Edward, this is part of life. Edward! Hi.
Oh, shit. All right,
Edward. Go ahead, Eddie. Come on over there.
Here, do you want to try it anyway?
Your electric thing is back here. He's healthy now. Good, Edward. Here's your capable of feeling. There's a lot of heart and mind in that little bastard. Brainless in the end. Yeah. Everyone, cigarette, Eddie? Cigarette? Yeah, your future's been carved up for you, Eddie. Oh, Lord. There we go, man. All right. Okay. Hot damn. That's it. That's right, man. Very good. Wee! Woo! Wee! Woo! Wee! Hi, I'm Edward.
I'll be here.
Thank you.
Thank you, man.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
He has to live with the fruits of his... You'll be lonely in here, won't you, Eddie? I have to go to Colorado. I have to go away. You'll be by yourself. But I'll come back. Don't worry. You won't be alone. You won't be alone. You won't be alone. That's a good one. You won't be alone. You'll hate that once you start picking it up.
A long, long time ago, I can still remember how that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had my chance,
Showtime.
That I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February made me shiver with every paper I'd deliver. Bad news on the doorstep, I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride. Something touched me deep inside the day the music died.
Happy birthday, Senator.
So bye-bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. And them good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, this'll be the day that I die. This'll be the day that I die.
My God! Christ,
this is my boy.
Yeah. This is the darkest figure in politics I've ever met.
How are you? See, I used to know when Hunter was due to come to Washington because I would start to get his mail. he would have it forwarded, which was a sure sign that soon he would be on our doorstep. I don't know what Senator McGovern said about Hunter's book, Fear and Loathing on the Campaign Trail, but I have been quoted many times, and I'll say it again. It was the most accurate and least factual account of that campaign.
Say one other thing. That book was written for Rolling Stones as the campaign progressed. It wasn't something written from the hindsight of the campaign. Those right, chapters okay. rolled off. His typewriter as the campaign moved along, And it was really rather remarkable, the foresight he had as to what was going to happen. So I must say, I run into that book even yet all over this country. It's become a kind of a folk piece of the 72 campaign.
Anyway, we did care then. It was fun. And I thank you for that, for bringing me into a humdinger of just a way of participating in politics. And I'm into local politics now, but that's the way it should be. Even a 22% loss.
Bye, Miss America.
Well, this may not be the most cheerful message for you to remember for 20 years, but this is mainly the conclusion I came to. I was very depressed after 72. This may be the year when we finally come face to face with ourselves, finally just lay back and say it, that we are really just a nation of 220 million used car salesmen. That's up to about 280 million now. With all the money we need to buy guns and no qualms at all about killing anybody else in the world who tries to make us uncomfortable. The more things change, the more they stay the same. The tragedy of all this is that George McGovern, for all his mistakes and all his imprecise talk about new politics and the honesty of government, end quote, is one of the few men who have run for president of the United States in this century who really understands what a fantastic monument to all the best instincts of the human race this country might have been if we could have kept it out of the hands of greedy little hustlers like Richard Nixon. McGovern made some stupid mistakes, but in context, they seem almost frivolous compared to the things Richard Nixon does every day of his life on purpose, as a matter of policy and a perfect expression of everything he stands for. Jesus, where will it end? How low do you have to stoop in this country to be president?
This'll be the day that I die.
Yeah, this is the pitch of a book.
They were singing, bye bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee.
Yeah, he would be right next to me in the convertible, lighting the cigarette the same way. And it got very peculiar, particularly for my friends around here who didn't know what to make of it. But he was getting into his role. Yeah, the idea came up to, as it did, well, let's drive to Freedom, Idaho tonight and buy some huge pistols tomorrow. The factory's up there. Yes, sir. He was right there. And we finally looked at the map and realized it was like 1,200 miles in an open convertible. And then back. Back is the hard part. So we had the factory send those guns here. They're very rare, very hard to get.
Somebody has called here six times and hung up.
Tracy.
Why would you do that?
Fear. That's it. Like breathing. White tank?
No, the green one over here.
Well, it gets there real fast. I mean, it's a big punch.
Fucking hell. I hit all five of those, but got it at a great price. Okay, God's mercy on you.
God damn, I thought that was Hunter.
He's getting it down now.
I didn't ever see that he was getting me. It looked like a kid up to some trick. You know, some nasty habit that he'd grow out of pretty soon.
Hey, Mr.
It made him a lot of fun.
I'm not sleepy, and there's no place I'm going.
You're going with me. That's
all right.
That's given.
Why do you say that?
You did this to me.
Shh.
It's your fault.
You've done well.
I held up?
Oh, absolutely. The price is done.
Though I know that evening's empire has returned into sand. Vanished from my hand, left me blindly here to stand, but still not sleeping.
What?
My weariness of me.
You want me to sell books here? Is this it? I'm going to sit here and sell books.
Have a seat.
Nice to meet you, sir. Thank you very much.
I'm sorry he's not able to autograph anything this evening.
Would you please?
No, I'm sorry, he can't sign anything tonight. There are so many people in line.
Maybe if you were naked, I might sign it for you.
I'll do it.
Hunter,
I'll
please.
Do it.
Please.
You got it.
Don't even. No, I'm sorry. He's not able to autograph anything tonight. He's not allowed to.
I'm just kidding.
Okay. Okay. Moving right along.
Who threw that?
He did.
Who do you think threw it? The stork?
Yeah.
That's pretty impressive.
Thank you.
Mr. Thompson, how are you? I'm glad you made it.
You better give me the drugs now because you'll be arrested on the way out.
Hey there. How you doing? Happy nice to meet you finally.
I'm in pain.
You're in pain?
Why do you ask?
Hey, I just wanted to say, being a young man, and reading this book for the first time, you're very influential, and I think you're very cool. You know, I just turned 21, and, you know, you're a generation ahead of me, but I think that's so cool.
Be careful about doing this stuff.
I am. I'm very careful. You too. All
right, here we go.
Johnny passing in just as a moment.
I want myself pictures I see these days as an observer.
As an observer, not a perpetrator. I think that's the whole point, is to look that image.
What's that? Oh.
The image.
Yeah, a long shot and closing it, that's all we need.
We just have to see how we... just long shot closing it, how does that work?
Sorry, I don't know the language.
No, it sounded great. It sounded incredibly confident, much more than I am. Long shot, close in.
Yes,
yeah, I wish I could do that. I can't do that. Yeah, but you just,
I use words.
I just point and grunt.
Yeah.
More or less.
I don't have any special effects. Writers don't have any benefit of that. Yeah, you fucking cheap dilettante bastards.
You can just write anything and it's all there. We've got to make it real. We've got to put substance to it.
Yeah.
It's not easy. Images. 1,000 words. Is it? Each one of these, 1,000 words. And I don't think Lucy got 1,000 words. I mean,
she looks degenerate. She looks depraved.
She's so clean.
Clean? Are you nuts? That's a goddamn depraved child.
She don't care about me. She's gone with the hula hula boys.
No, the wild guess I'd say is probably me. Did you?
Yeah.
Hey. Just looking at you with that elegant mustache you have reminds me that I look real fucking good in a mustache. What are you planning on doing this show? Oh, come on.
I have no idea.
8 hours I sit out here and really, I'm starting to believe it. Nobody has any idea. Let's drink some whiskey, bud.
Yeah.
Whiskey, to your health.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. That's nice of you. Thanks. Okay.
I don't drink it, man. It makes me sick. I get really ill.
You're the one. Oh!
Fuck.
Stop.
that little thing. Fuck.
Boy, you're real good with that bat.
I was hoping it would come around faster, you know.
It would speed up.
Yeah, right, yeah. Yeah.
Shooting now.
You're just sitting there on your own, observing.
Yeah.
Johnny comes through, out of the corner of his eye, spots something that seems odd. Turns, there's a moment of eye contact, and Johnny walks on. And it's just that brief moment. Was it there? Did we see it? Did we not? Was it?
Yeah.
That's a better way of doing it. Yeah?
A glimpse of Marlowe.
Yeah, that's it. Just a brief, ghosty image.
Yeah.
Well, whatever you want to do, I'll be there.
Yeah. Are you going to be in the shot with us?
No, I'm not going to be here. I'm behind the camera.
You're an eagle maniac.
All right, it's a late place now.
Here we go. Are you and you are going to be in this?
No, I'm not. I'm not going to be
here. All right, shooting now.
Here we go. Are you and you are going to be in this? Shooting
now. The final guy. What's wrong?
Okay, we'll go again.
Okay, it's a real one.
The background. That's
my good. Yeah, I was demanding her. What? Oh, yeah, marijuana cover. The best enema movie. Decade, everybody involved with it is lumped into a foul category of predatory drug freak.
Who wrote the book will be thanks to you. We'll all go down with you. It's just a movie.
Yeah, that's what. Tell that to the mother of some kid who's stabbed in the back by some dope fiend out of Vegas and blames it on this book.
Well, yeah.
Blames it on me.
Yeah. Some kids take acid and rent a car and drive to Vegas.
And they'll start talking like hunters.
You ask, Layla.
Yes.
How I feel and why I feel that way.
Yeah.
Well, take a look at this.
Will it explain it to me?
And tell me who caused this man's unhappiness.
That's really sad. You know what I was just thinking? I was just thinking hell for you would be stuck someplace with no one else there, no one to talk to. You'd just be alone. It's like, you know, like if the tree falls in the forest.
Stupid, presumptuous.
But nobody could, no one would see you. No one would hear you.
All right. I don't want to hear about your crazy shit.
What is
that? People don't have any idea what's going on.
Picture of him alone in bed.
It's very sad.
It's really sad. It's really sad. It's pathetic.
It's like a ghost.
It's awful.
Yeah. The last postcard from the October month. Well, I have a very strong sense of coming back around and having been here before. Your judgment is to come back as what you deserve to be. Now think about that, Bubba. Now, there are people in this room, I would guess, there usually are in most rooms, who will come back as three-legged dogs on a Navajo Indian reservation. Insult intended there, any Indian reservation. Yeah. I'm not worried about any judgments by karmas. It's pretty good. A lot better than most people. But I think I'll come back in a higher form. I've been doing it for a while. It's been about at least 1,000 years since I've been the direct cause of, direct cause of death. I have caused some pain and some injuries, but always to the right people.
Did you have fun in the last existence?
It's never a lot of fun, you know. It's a lot of work. And what you want to do is get as much rest as you can between gigs.
What are you going to do with the farm? How far?
I wouldn't have filled it with a glass mixture. I'm going to put this, pump this down my chimney into the house, and it will harden from the bottom up instantly, and it'll be translucent, and people will be able to come to the windows in front and see figures through this hazy glass cube. So you ask, yeah, that's where I'll be. I'll be in a glass cube on the owl farm with people paying, I don't know, $100 to look in. And I won't be around to get it.
What are these things called anyway? They're
called calla lilies.
Calla lilies.
C-A-L-L-A-Lilies.
Catherine Hepburn was able to pronounce calla lilies like no one else ever did.
Oh my goodness.
Except Hannah.
Now I'll never be able to.
I was
going to
run. Thank you.
Oh, thanks.
Come here, Mars. Come here, back.
Mars.
Sorry.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I never
know. Don't worry about it. Crying on George Clinton's shoulder.
Oh, yeah, because he knows
you. Yeah, whatever. Hunter, it's not your medium. You didn't write it, you didn't do it, you're not in it.
Well, it's so depressing.
How is any filmmaker going to get into your head?
This is my chosen time. Like I had to be, well, I'm not there yet. But
the objective is not to be led anywhere.
All right, kids, let's go.
All right. They look pretty clean there.
All right, okay. Let's jump.
How do you feel having this made into a movie after all these years?
It's a very strange experience. Profoundly strange.
Did you get it?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Wow. Beautiful. Wow. Those are for you, Johnny.
Calla lily.
It's an old tradition.
Calla lily.
You want error and speculum.
Actually, so wait here and I'll see that you're vomiting.
Yeah, you know, I don't mind putting on an act for
him. Nice and close together. Nice and close together.
He's coming.
So what am I saying? I'm proud of this man. I respect and admire his vitality, his courage, his insight, his perverse resistance to security and predictability, his deliberate disregard for propriety, his ability to make me see and think differently. Ultimately, I love and respect him because he really lives. For better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, he lives his life.
Boys, can I lock you up here? Lights off. I'm going to Florida.
Let go!
Go, Miami.
Sir.
parts with the steward is high over long out of sound. She's also spending some time on the island. Too much city madness gives her the blues. They make her date to go dancing and dining. It seems neither has that much to lose. The weather is here. I wish you were beautiful. My thoughts aren't too clear. But don't run away. My girlfriend's a bore. My job is too dutiful. Hell, nobody's perfect. Would you like to play? I feel together today.